Back in 1944, the global reserve currency became the United States dollar. At the time, the dollar was backed by the world's largest gold reserves. Because of this, the dollar was considered to be the safest currency ever created. Until one day in 1971, the United States government detached the dollar's link to gold, resulting in a currency no longer pillared by scarcity, and instead relying on its value being simply assured by the US government. This was the beginning of fiat currency, money backed solely by the governments that issue them. As of today, not a single fiat currency, including the British pound, the euro, or the Japanese yen, are fully backed by gold. Money has essentially become a belief system.
In the history of money that now spans tens of thousands of years, there have been maybe five major changes. From pure barter exchange to the introduction of the first abstraction of value, shells, feathers, beads, nuts, stones, and then precious metals, and then paper money, and then plastic money, and now network money. Bitcoin introduces a platform on which you can run currency as an application on a network without any central points of control, a system completely decentralized like the internet itself. It is not money for the internet, but the internet of money.
If you look at the US dollar and all the other fiat currencies in the world, as they are called when they are in fact government money, not backed up by gold, they lose value, purchasing power, year over year through inflation.
One of the main issues with fiat currencies is the lack of a defined money supply. Without a fixed amount, central banks can endlessly print money without limitation, a phenomenon called quantitative easing.
Especially in the world where today people are printing money like crazy. Yeah. Central banks are printing money like crazy. They call it quantitative easing. I mean, this. You know, how many syllables that is, it's amazing.
The central banks are printing money like crazy. You can see it at the balance sheet, it's going up. They are printing the money, then they are buying bonds on the secondary market, and that's how they pump money into the system. And that leads eventually to inflation, not only from the money supply, but also it decreases your purchasing power. And whatever it might be a debt crisis, a currency crisis, or a combination of both, then people might panic sell their stocks and stuff, go into US dollar, but eventually go into safe haven assets like gold, silver, Bitcoin. And that's what we are probably about to see.
You have about eight people all over the world that prints money out at basically whatever the discretionary amount they want to print are. And it's fascinating to me how few people really understand that political movements, kind of handshakes, backdoor deals, have a massive influence in how much money is created. That is one of the biggest selling points for Bitcoin, because Bitcoin is a systematic, programmatic deployment of money supply.
We're using a debt-based money system that can be inflated and printed and increased without our cooperation. Central banks around the world will unilaterally decide to increase the money supply in all these countries.
Printing money leads to increased rates of inflation and, in turn, debasing a currency's overall value. Today, participants of the fiat monetary system are penalized for storing their own wealth due to this constant depreciation. Over the past century, the US dollar has lost over 95% of its value, meaning $100 in the early 1900s has the equivalent purchasing power of just $5 today. As of 2019, the United States had more debt than its national GDP, meaning all the money generated by the entire country in a given year would still not be enough to cover its debt. As if that wasn't bad enough, things get even worse. In recent years, citizens of countries such as Argentina, Venezuela, Iran, Zimbabwe, among others, have felt the strain of hyperinflation. The rapid decline of a national currency's value as a direct result of governments printing money in excessive quantities. In some cases, national currencies have lost up to a third of their value in a single night due to hyperinflation, leaving entire countries in financial crises. So what makes Bitcoin a better form of money? In contrast to fiat currencies, Bitcoin has a fixed supply and actually shares many of the same characteristics of gold. Like gold, Bitcoin cannot simply be created arbitrarily. Gold must be mined out of the ground, and Bitcoin must be mined via digital means. And just as gold has a limited and finite supply, so does Bitcoin. In fact, there are only 21 million Bitcoins that can be mined in total. Once miners have unearthed or unlocked this many Bitcoins, the planet's supply will essentially be tapped out. This fixed supply means that Bitcoin is effectively immune to monetary inflation.
Prior to Bitcoin, money for throughout human history was typically precious metals, specifically gold. And gold is great money, but it doesn't work very well for normal transactions. It's very cumbersome and burdensome. And so the only way you can have gold work in modern society with transactions is to digitize it, which means you have a vault somewhere with gold deposits, and then you have digital gold receipts, and those receipts can trade around like money. And there was actually a company that tried this called eGold back in the 90s or early 2000s. They started getting some decent traction, and then governments shut them down. And the issue there was, of course, the centralization. If you have to trust that an entity will redeem your money for real gold, or you have to trust that that entity will continue thriving and perpetuating, the money system is doomed. You can't have a money system that is reliant on any person or any company. So eGold got destroyed. And when Bitcoin came out, it was that decentralized aspect, the fact that it was immutable, could not be shut down, had no borders, had no entity, had no central servers. These things made it something substantially different than anything that had existed before.
Going right back, of course, there was no money. If you were somebody who grew crops, you could only exchange them with other people who grew crops. And it just limited society to tiny little villages. And then eventually, once people started exchanging tokens, the earliest types of tokens were actually tools. So you might have somebody who swapped a very early kind of shovel or digging fork with somebody in exchange for crops. And gradually, this is such a fascinating story, in very, very early China, instead of swapping like a shovel or a fork with somebody, they started shrinking them so that they would give somebody a representation of a shovel or a fork. And those were the first tokens, because it wasn't a barter, it was something that represented something else. And of course, over following centuries, people used all kinds of things that were scarce and which had value through scarcity, like seashells or stones or beads or jewelry. And of course, that morphed into people exchanging gold or silver, which then very gradually the idea of standardization came in. People had to trust that the gold was pure. So then you had the idea of coins coming in, and then paper money. And very, very gradually, we evolved to this system that we have now. But it's my belief that if people thought more about what money actually is, which basically money is just a way of transporting value through time.
People say Bitcoin's not backed anything. Okay, what's the dollar backed by? Well, the full faith and credit of the US government. Really, if you look at the decline in the dollar value, I don't give them much faith and I don't give them much credit, because they've done a horrible job.
So is Bitcoin a new digital gold? When classifying gold and money, we often look at these three defining characteristics: store of value, medium of exchange, unit of account. But does Bitcoin really meet these characteristics? And which are the most important?
I think you can conceptualize Bitcoin as digital gold, as digital property, as digital money, as digital energy. All of those are reasonable metaphors. And if money is, is the universal most desirable commodity that we use to exchange value, right? It, in theory, it could become the unit of account and the medium of exchange and the store of value for all the capital and the civilization. And if I had to pick one thing to capitalize the civilization, I would say Bitcoin. Like, if there's $500 trillion worth of stuff in the world, right? And I was trying to figure out where I think money is energy. Money is monetary energy. It's economic energy, liquid energy in the civilization. And if I'm looking for a container to hold the energy, I think it's Bitcoin. That's the best container.
And now the market cap's pushing $1 trillion. It's already, I think, the fifth or sixth biggest currency. I believe it recently overtook the Swiss franc in terms of market cap and size in the global market. It's getting close now, about 50% or so, overtaking silver. So the global silver market's approximately just under $2 trillion. So certainly within a few months, Bitcoin will be vaulting over silver. It's on its way, in my belief, in 2021 to get halfway or so against the market capitalization of gold. That is, it would be $4 trillion on its way to $10 trillion. And then, you know, once it gets past gold, there's only the dollar is left. And the thing about Bitcoin is that it is the apex predator. It is the shark in an ocean full of goldfish.
Most importantly, it gives the world today a choice to have our value stored in a decentralized way, in a digital fashion, where the knowledge of the private key allows you access to your value, where that cannot be confiscated. That is the most important thing, that Bitcoin cannot be confiscated, because no one can steal information from my brain. There's always plausible deniability. And that, in that sense, is an unconfiscatable asset that's digital, that can be transferred anywhere in the world for very low cost, instantly, practically. In that sense, very, very valuable as a global asset class.
Bitcoin is limited. It's the only borderless money on the planet. I mean, the US dollar is accepted in most countries. But we know last year, right, they printed 20% of total supply in 1 year, and Biden's going to do the same this year.
Bitcoin survives partitioning of the world's internet. This is, for example, like a circumstance where, let's say, China and the US cut a fiber optic line between them, which won't happen. But hypothetically, you know, Bitcoin can even survive scenarios like that, which is really cool. Bitcoin is very, very resilient. And due to Bitcoin's, you know, very, very small block size, that enables Bitcoin full nodes to utilize different sort of communication mechanisms. Satellite, you can do over the air using ham radio, which is really, really, really cool. I love that stuff, using ham radio to propagate Bitcoin transactions. I mean, that is the ultimate resiliency. There's no way for the government to jam ham radio transactions everywhere. So that is like the last, even if they turn off the internet, you could still transact in Bitcoin using ham radio.
Bitcoin basically operates like a digital gold, a digital store of value. Gold and other precious metals are valued based on what's called the stock to flow ratio, basically using the same model of valuation that precious metals use. 1/62's worth of gold enters the economy every year. Now, this is a rough number, and if we found all gold on the planet Earth, there's still the potential that we could find gold on other planets. But with Bitcoin, no matter what you do, there's never going to be more than 21 million unless you got everybody in the world who owns Bitcoin to agree to inflate the Bitcoin supply. So you have to get them to agree to do something that's to their detriment, which is highly unlikely to happen. People are unlikely to do things that are not in their interest.
Bitcoin is an amazing store of value. It's a volatile store of value, but this volatility has been trending up over its lifetime. And what makes it the best store of value is the unconfiscatability property. What better property to your store of value is the fact that it's unconfiscatable? I can't think of one. Gold was a good unconfiscatable asset because you can bury it in the ground and no one has to know you have it. But with the invention of metal detectors, it becomes very, very challenging. Gold is no longer unconfiscatable because they'll find it, but they can't get your Bitcoin. So it is certainly a store of value for me. I would rather store my value in Bitcoin than anything else.
Gold was money historically. Today we have a digital world and digital payments. The whole infrastructure is built on the internet. So it would be hard to reintroduce gold because of the fact that the world looks completely different. from hundreds of years ago. So that's where Bitcoin comes in. Looking again at these properties, Bitcoin is fungible. One Bitcoin is just as valuable as the next Bitcoin. They are interchangeable, and it's extremely divisible, more divisible than any other form of money we've seen before. But most important, I think that Bitcoin will prove to be a very good store value over time because of its scarce supply. We can never inflate Bitcoin over the 21 million Bitcoin limit, and that is unique to Bitcoin. There's basically nothing else that has this absolute scarcity.
If central banks or governments start to use Bitcoin as a commodity, just like how they are using gold as a foreign reserve, then literally the price can skyrocket for Bitcoin.
So what would this internet of money look like for all these internet and smartphone users alike? A money that, unlike fiat, is decentralized, truly borderless, meaning there is no need for converting into local currencies. Censorship resistant and unconfiscatable, so that it cannot be altered or controlled by man. Bitcoin cannot be counterfeited or mixed with non-desirable elements. And Bitcoin is infinitely more transactable, with its amount being assured and its ability to be sent across the world instantaneously. Bitcoin is superior to all forms of money ever created and will only continue to improve as time goes on.
When you look at Swissborg
est sorti ce matin.
They have an app where you can buy crypto.
They connect to Binance, HitBTC, LMAX, and Kraken and find the
best rates in the markets.
What I like about Swissborg is that they have an amazing app
that can directly buy cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin and also cash out as well.
Through Swissborg, all assets will have a fiat gateway. And here is the thing.
Premium features gives you zero fee trading.
That is zero fees.
If you want to buy Bitcoin with fiat, I suggest you buy through Swissborg rather than Coinbase.
And if you're interested in trading the likes of Ethereum or Bitcoin, use Swissborg's application.
In a fast-moving and confusing crypto asset market, get an edge with Crypto Slate Edge. Enhanced, in-depth news coverage and extensive crypto asset and sector data are all part of your exclusive access as a member, helping you understand the market with features such as on-chain metrics and sentiments, all of which allow you to convert knowledge into action with an ad-free experience. As a bonus, access our private Telegram channel to receive live insights whilst engaging with the CryptoSlate community. Subscribe now at cryptoslate.com/edge.
Thank you.